80, 90, 100. Allez, embrassez-moi. Bisous, bisous, bisous.
T'as enlevé tous les posters de ta chambre.
Tu serais d'accord qu'on discute du Coran une fois par semaine tous les deux ?
Je peux pas lire le Coran avec une femme.
A legendary love story revisited, Pedro Almodovar takes a bittersweet look back at an artistic life and a troubling portrait of a radicalized youngster in Belgium. That's all coming up in today's film show. And for that, I'm joined by critic Lisa Nesselson. Hi, Lisa.
Hello, Olivia.
Well, let's start with the new film by Claude Lelouch, who actually won the Golden Palm in Cannes in 1966 for A Man and a Woman. Now, The Best Years of a Life, his latest film, takes up where that left off. This is really a one-off sort of story, isn't it?
Well, as a filmed exploit, absolutely. You know, just some background on Lelouch. When he released his first film as a very young man, 2021, a critic assessed it as follows. Remember the name Claude Lelouch, because you're never going to hear it again. Ouch! If you give up easily, that would have been a problem. But Lelouch is as tenacious as he is creative. Les plus belles années d'une vie is Lelouch's 49th film. There have been quite a few massive hits and a few clunkers along the way. But A Man and a Woman, Lelouch's sixth film, holds a special place in the hearts of filmgoers literally all over the world. I've heard it said that 1 billion people have seen the original. This sort of sequel, an unembarrassed ode to love, is very sweet and touching.
And quite incredibly for a sequel, the original cast is back over 50 years later.
Yes, it is incredible. Of course, makeup has always been used to age actors or to make them look younger inside the same movie. Jean-Pierre Léo played the character of Antoine Doinel for François Truffaut five films between 1959 and 1979, aging naturally as he went along. But nobody has done what Lelouch does here, which is to use the same two actors in the same roles, but older, 53 years later. Four actors, if you count the kids. Each of them had a child. Because Anouk Aimée and Jean-Louis Trintignant are superb actors, and Lelouch is a shameless romantic, the film they shot in chronological order in just 13 days is borderline corny, but surprisingly effective.
Okay, well, let's get an idea by taking a look at this clip.
Je peux vous demander pardon?
Pourquoi pardon?
Parce qu'on a beaucoup à se faire pardonner, surtout moi. Pardon, pardon, pardon.
Alors maintenant que vous m'avez demandé pardon si gentiment, qu'est-ce qu'on fait?
Ben, puisqu'on n'est pas arrivé à vivre ensemble, on peut essayer de mourir ensemble.
Avec cette belle lumière, vous voulez pas qu'on sorte dehors pour faire un selfie?
C'est quoi un selfie?
C'est quand on veut se souvenir d'un moment de bonheur.
Now, Trintignant's character, Jean-Louis Duroc, is in a retirement home. His memory is shot, but he does recall a certain Anne Gauthier, Anouk Aimée's character. Jean-Louis' son, Antoine, played by Antoine Cyr, who was 5 in real life in the first film and never acted again until now, seeks out Anne and asks her to visit his dad, thinking it might just jog his porous memory. She agrees, and Lelouch bounces back and forth using footage from the original A Man and a Woman, playing with time in a way to which film is really uniquely suited. You'd have to be Scrooge with the attention span of Donald Trump to not be touched by this endeavor. And even if you don't know the original movie, I'm willing to bet you know the theme song, which I am now going to have some fun with. This film is really pretty neat from a movie seat. Its sense of romance bittersweet is a real treat. And if you dare to disagree, then you'll hear from me, because you're wrong. So says this song.
Iconic, Lisa Nesselson. Thank you very much. Now, the march of time is also a major theme in Pain and Glory, and its leading man, Antonio Banderas, just picked up the prize for Best Actor at the Cannes Film Festival. He was playing Pedro Almodovar's alter ego in this film, and they've been working together since the 1980s. What did you think of that award? Do you think it was deserved?
Absolutely, hands down. Banderas has said in interviews that if he hadn't had a heart attack roughly 2 years ago, he wouldn't have been in touch with his own mortality in quite the way this role requires. So I'm really sorry he had a major heart incident, but filmgoers get the benefit of the deepening of craft, the melancholy and doubt in the actor's eyes. As a successful Spanish film director, suffering from writer's block after the death of his beloved mother, played in flashbacks by another sturdy Almodovar troop member, the never less than superb Penelope Cruz. You know, when I was a budding cinephile, I'd never have imagined that feature films about the awakening of homosexual desire would one day be a dime a dozen. Hear the way Almodovar evokes these stirrings of same-sex attraction with bittersweet mastery makes his flashback seem, if not completely brand new, then close to it.
Okay, well, let's take a look at Pain and Glory, Antonio Banderas' seventh collaboration with Pedro Almodovar, with a word from the actor after his win at Cannes.
Ah, qué bonito. ¿Qué son esos árboles? ¿Abetos?
Pinos. ¿Me vas a explicar de una puta vez para qué has venido a verme después de 32 años?
La Filmoteca ha restaurado Sabor. Han decidido que es un clásico. Y la han programado para un ciclo de cine rodado en Madrid. Bueno, me llamaron para pedirme que la presentáramos juntos.
¿Y no saben que no nos hablamos desde el rodaje?
Bueno, si lo saben, no me han dicho nada.
Alberto, los chismes envejecen. Como las personas.
In Almodóvar, in the character of Salvador Mayo, was the biggest challenge. Without doing something that looks like a pastiche, I didn't want to do an imitation of him. I mean, in terms of mannerism, I was just trying to create the character from the inside out, and I needed his help, obviously, you know, in this case, more than any other time. Because it has been probably the most interesting experience of my career by far.
Congratulations to Antonio Banderas there. Now, next to a film that's entirely free of nostalgia from the Dardenne brothers. They're known for being rigorously contemporary, and that's certainly the case in this latest film, Young Ahmed. And these Belgian filmmakers are actually in that rare club of directors who've won the Golden Palm at Cannes, not once, but twice, in fact. And this time they won the directing prize. Do you think that was warranted?
Well, I'm usually very taken by the spare, absolutely convincing, socially conscious tales they tell. But this time they seemed more dutiful than inspired. So I wouldn't have given them the directing prize, but 7 out of the 9 people on the jury are directors, and they're the ones who hand out the prizes. Astonishingly, nobody asked me. When we meet the young Ahmed of the title, at age 13, he's already an insufferably devout young Muslim, obsessed with the concept of purity and convinced via a not terribly charismatic imam that a good male Muslim doesn't shake hands with a woman, can insult his own mother in Arabic for drinking alcohol, and should go ahead and kill his school teacher, also a Muslim, because she's dating somebody she shouldn't. The teacher, Madame Inez, it should be noted, is a compassionate and deeply dedicated professional who even took time out from her schedule to help Ahmed with his dyslexia. The hardliners in the community object to her because she wants to hold classes to teach Arabic via popular songs so the kids will have a full vocabulary and not just the words found in the Quran.
Well, the subject matter is certainly very topical. Let's take a look at Young Ahmed.
C'est la deuxième fois que je viens, mais c'est encore plus dur que la première. J'aimerais tellement que tu redeviennes comme tu étais.
Tu veux le tenir?
C'est normal que ça prenne du temps pour comprendre ce que t'as fait. T'as quand même essayé de tuer quelqu'un, et contrairement à ce que disait ton cousin, la mort c'est autre chose qu'une piqûre de moustique. Ahmed !
Ahmed !
Arrête-toi ! Allez,
c'est moi.
So it's not just this very devout young man. There's a whole cast of characters who, as always with the Dardenne brothers, seem very authentic in terms of their roles in the society that he's a part of.
Yeah, the Dardennes even said when they started out to create this character, they didn't realize that he was going to be surrounded by, I don't know, maybe 8, 9, 10 people who are trying to get him out of this, you know, rigid mindset. The social workers and the others who cross paths with Ahmed, they're incredibly tolerant, incorporating his dedication to praying 5 times a day, even making room for his prayer rug. Ahmed is saving himself for marriage and believes that even a French-style peck on the cheek will displease Allah. The Dardenne show us fanaticism grounded not in faith but in a form of blind stupidity. More and more French-language films, by the way, are addressing the radicalization of European young people who have pretty decent lives but reject them as they're drawn to beliefs that don't necessarily appear anywhere in Islamic holy texts. Accepting their award in Cannes, the brothers said they made a hopeful film. I hope they're right.
Okay, so you said that you wouldn't necessarily have given that directing prize to the Dardenne brothers. Would you have seen that prize go to someone else instead?
Ah, well, I probably would have moved Céline Sciamma of France higher up on the roster of prizes. They gave her screenwriting, and I think she was a real candidate for directing, and I wouldn't have been against giving it to Quentin Tarantino for his magnificent Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. But we'll be seeing those later.
Finally, we're wrapping up, Lisa, with something that you've got news of. It's perhaps the most generous film initiative around these days, courtesy of the César Academy here in France, which is the local equivalent of the Oscars. It's called Les Nuits en Or, or The Golden Nights. Can you tell us more about it and who's involved?
Well, this is something that you could condense as this. Make a short film and win an all-expenses-paid trip to Europe. This is the most generous initiative I know of. Each year, the César's Academy invites all of the filmmakers who won their country's top prize for a short film to come and show their work to audiences in Europe. So if you won the Magritte in Belgium, you're in. So the best short film of the year from South Africa, Brazil, Korea, Canada, and the people who make them, who tend to become lifelong friends bonding on this trip around Europe, showing their work. So right now, the film programs are circulating all over France and will culminate in Paris on the 18th, 19th, and 20th of June, including a gala on the 17th at UNESCO, which pairs each winner with an established filmmaker. It's a magnificent show of belief, I think, in the idea that cinema really can bring people closer together all over the world.
A fantastic initiative. Thank you very much for joining us this week, Lisa. And if you're in Paris, do check out Les Nuits d'Or at the UGC Odeon, which is in the Saint-Germain neighborhood here in Paris, to see those films. And if you're not, we'll leave you with a short preview of what's in store. Do remember to check out our website for more movie news and arts and culture. There's more news coming up on France 24 just after this.